warm welcome to Power News, your window to the power sector. I'm Juhi Rajput. Let's begin with the top stories. CVC refers coal block allocation case to CBI. Coal Ministry identifies 54 blocks for allocation through auction. Coal India profit drops 5% on wage hike provision. Kudankulam nuclear plant to sell power at ₹2.65 per unit. GAIL net slips 38% on subsidy burden. Lanco net profit drops 39% on high interest cost. Power Grid plans ₹1 lakh crore capex for 12th plan. Reliance Power and Shell to build LNG terminal. And BHEL wins ₹1,143 crore order from NTPC. Well, after the top stories, let's move on to the news of the week. With the mercury rising this month, short-term power prices have seen an increase of 20 to 25%, with the highest price at which power was traded touching ₹5 per unit. The average for power trading was ₹3.5 to 4. Due to mismatch in demand and power supply, the prices are expected to increase further.
There is a shortage of about 9,000 megawatt in overall demand from the grid at a little over 1 lakh megawatt. The country's biggest power exchange, IEX, receiving purchase bids for 72,000 megawatt for sale every day. Traded volumes on the exchange have risen to 45,000 to 50,000 from 35,000 to 40,000 megawatt hour per day in April this year.
In the months of June, July, August, the demand and supply is highly weather sensitive, with the result that many suppliers and many purchasers, they don't tie up for the firm quantum. It is for that reason that because of the uncertainty factor, volumes are likely to be high for next 1 to 2 months, and then it may stabilize again in the range of 40 to 50 MU or even a little below that.
Jindal Steel and Power, Lanco, Infratech and JSW Energy are among the largest traders in merchant power. Expert feels merchant power rates will remain on the higher side till the issues in demand and supply as well as coal shortage are addressed. Almost every year in the summer, the prices move upwards.
Because of non-availability of the linkage coal, many of the power stations, especially the merchant power plants, are dependent on the market coal or the imported coal, where the cost has gone very high. Number one is due to international coal price, and number two, due to devaluation of rupee. So purchase of power, capability to purchase is another issue. How much can the state electricity boards pay? Therefore, today the position is that some of the power stations are not able to operate because they are not able to produce the power at the paying capacity of the purchasers.
Last year, in the same period, the average rates were 2.9 per unit. There was a particular problem in October when the coal shortage crisis sent short-term power prices and volumes haywire at the exchanges.
The power industry has been facing inadequate coal supply for some time as the production of government-owned Coal India is unable to match their rising need. Demand for coal in India has grown at an annual rate exceeding 8.4% over the past 5 years, and that of annual supply has not been more than 5.4%. For 2011-12, while India's coal demand is estimated at 696 million tons, 554 million tons is likely to be available, leaving a gap of 142 million tons to be met through import.
Data from the Central Electricity Authority shows about 30 plants are at critical level with coal stock of less than 7 days. This might aggravate the power supply problem. There are 95 thermal power plants with a total capacity of 91,487 megawatt. After a directive from the Prime Minister's office and later a presidential directive, Coal India signed some fuel supply agreements for commitment of at least 80% supply. However, some power companies have refused to sign the FSA because of various clauses they have objected to. Recently, NTPC alleged that Coal India's status as the country's only coal miner is harming the power sector and the entire nation, and CIL's its inability to supply adequate amount of fuel is threatening NTPC's expansion plans. Almost 11,000 megawatt of coal projects of NTPC is stranded due to lack of coal linkages. Expert feels that imported coal could not be a solution and the country should increase local output. One way of doing this is to open up the sector, but the government lacks willingness to do that. Opening up coal mining for private players would persist until the country appoints a coal regulator.
To talk on the subject, we have with us Mr. Ashok Khurana, Director General, Association of Power Producers, and Mr. Pradeep Lenka, CEO, Power Business, Aditya Birla Group. Let me take the first question from Mr. Khurana. need for a coal regulator is felt for a long time, and even the Committee on Coal Sector Reforms proposed the need for coal regulator for bringing efficiency to the coal sector. So do you feel there is an urgent need of having coal regulator in the country?
See, the need for coal regulator today is imperative. In fact, we cannot delay the appointment of coal regulator any further if we want to salvage the power and the coal sector. If you have a coal regulator, one can approach the regulator on the pricing issues, on the quality issues, transportation issues, quantum issues. But now we only approach Ministry of Coal, which is the owner of Coal India. So what happens is they become the judge of their own cause.
Mr. Linker, what do you feel? How much could this situation be improved by bringing coal regulation?
I'm not sure whether the regulator can play much role in the allocation of coal or transport of the coal or the production side of the coal. But a regulator has got an over-empowering function which can be always a constant monitor for the sector. So my recommendation to the government will be to have a strong regulator with representation from outside the government bodies and user industries than bringing in the retired bureaucrats from the government who head the regulatory functions and also do a similar job that they are currently doing in the Ministry of Coal.
Mr. Khurana, Coal India is the only company in the world where the production has gone down but the profit has gone up. What do you have to say about this?
For simple reason, it's a monopoly. And all those who are power producers are the steel producers. They have no other way out except to go to Coal India. They can keep on supplying the quantities they want to supply and keep on charging the price they want to charge. They always will be in a profit.
Mr. Lenka, let's have your views on this.
This is a paradigm which is unexplainable at the moment, because Coal India, being the monopoly, has been insisting on raising the coal prices. The price revisions have happened 4 times in the last 1 year itself, and this has resulted in the electricity tariff going up and coal becoming way beyond the common man's ability to buy. The only comparison or the only thing that Coal India thinks is the right way is that they are looking at comparison of at prices if the same is imported from abroad. What they do not understand is a import parity pricing in coal is not a possibility, unlike in the oil sector. So this is the main reason why there is an anomaly. While the coal production is going down, the Coal India's profit is doubling.
Mr. Khurana, Ministry of Coal says no power plant will be closed due to coal shortage. But as per CEA data dated 20th May 2012, on an average, 28 power stations face critical fuel supply position with less than 7 days of stock.
See, I am not aware as to what Ministry of Coal means by close. I agree. Close means completely shut down, they may not be. But to my mind, any plant operating below 50% or 55-60% is a closed plant. And it's a sheer waste of capital. As on today also, approximately 25,000 or above plants are operating at suboptimal level. So you have a situation where power shortages coexist with the plants unable to function or run to full capacity because of Coal India not able to supply adequate quantity of coal.
Mr. Lenka, we are asking coal mining sector to open for the private players. But at the same time, we are also talking about rupees 10 lakh crore scam. 6 times the size of 2G scam, and CVC has already called for CBI probe of the process of allocation of blocks between 2006 and 2009.
I may quote that today even there are certain editorials who have championed the coal nationalization should be revoked. So in my mind, bringing in private mining firm into coal production is the right idea. And it will bring in certain amount of discipline and certain amount of seriousness into the mining business. As far as the scam is concerned, I don't agree to this being a scam, because It is only in hindsight there is a comparison that if something is auctioned, it will fetch money, and all those mines which have not been auctioned are a scam.
Mr. Khurana, do you feel that the country should open the coal sector for the private players?
See, my idea is we should not confuse two issues. Opening a sector does not mean going to scams. Opening a sector means introducing competition, benchmarking pricing, efficiency. If you compare the Coal India efficiency against the world best, they are far below. So, opening up economy does not mean any scam. Those are implementation and operational issues. One should not confuse between the operational issues and the implementation issues and the policy issues.
Thanks, Mr. Khurana and Mr. Lenka, for joining us in Power News. It's time to take a quick break. On the other side, we'll have with us Mr. Ajoy Mehta, MD, MSEDCL, to talk on Maharashtra's power scenario. Stay tuned.
फिर बिजली गुल, अब तो 2-4 घंटे की छुट्टी।
गांव का केबल ही घटिया है।
देश में बिजली उत्पादन का लगभग 40% भाग दोषपूर्ण घटिया केबल और बिजली की चोरी में व्यर्थ चला जाता है। क्यों ना एक ऐसा पावर केबल चुने जो बिजली बचाए और शॉर्ट सर्किट का जोखिम घटाए।
सर्वोत्तम केबल रवीन केबल, प्राइम कैब, रवीन केबल्स उत्पादन।
To turn movements into a ballet, you need a choreographer. To turn products into integrated solutions, you need Larsen & Toubro. L&T's engineering expertise, manufacturing capability, and application experience by introducing new levels of pace, performance, and convenience at major utilities around the country. Integrated solutions in electrical and automation from Larsen & Toubro. जल से जल तक, मेगावाट से मेगावाट्स तक, SJVN लिमिटेड।
वेलकम बैक। After the increase in petrol prices, electricity charges are also likely to go up in Maharashtra. MSEDCL, the State Power Utilities Distribution Arm, has proposed an average 15% rise in electricity charges for domestic consumers. It has also proposed an overall 100% to 300% increase in fixed demand charges and energy charges for all category of consumers. The MSEDCL has submitted its proposal to the Maharashtra Electricity Regulatory Commission and has invited suggestions and objections from citizens regarding the proposed increase in tariff. To talk in detail on this issue, we have with us Mr. Ajoy Mehta, MD, MSEDCL. Good evening, Mr. Mehta, and welcome to Power News. In June, BEST increased its power tariff by 24%, and now MSEDCL proposed an average 15% rise in electricity charges for domestic consumers in Maharashtra. Don't you feel these stiff hikes in electricity tariffs would hit Mumbai hard?
Yes, we have proposed a hike in tariffs, and we do realize that any tariff rise does affect the consumer very, very adversely. It does add to the living cost. It is a problem for the common consumer. But today, with rising coal costs, rising cost of fuel, and also that we are now making an attempt to supply a reliable power supply, which needs much more investment in infrastructure, the cost of power is bound to rise. And as it rises, there is no other option for us but to pass this on to the consumer, even though personally, we also feel that yes, it does burden the consumer.
The Power Ministry allowed power producers to raise tariffs if fuel cost of new projects rise. The move would hurt consumers but rescue large private investments that are threatened by uncertainty over fuel and tariffs.
The Ministry of Power, in fact, has taken a laudable decision and has recommended, including the Forum of Regulators has recommended, that fuel adjustment charge, that is, as the coal and other prices go up, it should be automatically passed through to the consumer. The concept behind this is that we should not borrow money from banks, which is a normal business, so that the interest burden of money that is borrowed to run normal business comes down. And being a government company, the minute the interest burden comes down, this is passed back to the consumer in terms of cheaper and lower tariffs. So this is an order, that is why it was passed off by the Forum of Regulators and also by the Government of India. Unfortunately, in Maharashtra, our regulator has still not adopted these regulations, as a result of which we find that a gap is rising between what we are able to recover from the consumer and what we are paying for coal prices. And this gap is being filled by bank loans, which ultimately means more interest and ultimately goes back to the consumer in terms of higher tariffs. So we have made a very strong petition before the Honorable Commission that this needs to be relooked, and this is in consumer interest, not in company interest.
The combined losses of DISCOMs rose up to 1 lakh crore in 2011-12. Most of the power DISCOMs and SEBs are financially poor to buy expensive power. Even if power generation shoots up, there is an apprehension that there would not be enough buyers.
Well, you know, the losses have gone up. DISCOMs, the gaps between the revenue and the expenditures is expanding. I would not only say use the word expanding, it's been ballooning. It's a cause for concern. But if you ask me, the reason they are twofold. One, the utilities are themselves to blame. Two, we have also certain blame that has to be taken by the regulators on this issue. There have been utilities who have not even submitted their revenue requirements for 4-5 years. Now, who do you blame? If you don't even ask for a price rise, who is going to give you a price rise? That is one where the utilities have blamed. And therefore, you are not even telling the consumer what is your true cost. So there the utilities to blame for this ballooning gap. On the other side, utilities like us have already brought the true cost in front of the consumer and the regulators now and then in every possible forum. Our accounts are available to everybody transparently. It's there on the net. They are audited by the CAG. We bring it before the Honorable Commission. It's for the people to see. But having brought this all in public domain, it is now time for the regulators to accept those costs and allow a fair amount of that cost to be passed on to the consumer. Now, unless that happens, this gap is going to rise. So this is where I think the problem has come.
To achieve the desired goal of power sector reform, there is an urgent need for bringing the regulatory reforms in the sector and reviewing periodically the performance of the state electricity regulator. What do you have to say?
There has to be reforms. There is no way we can survive this. I can see, yes, there was a time in the country when we were absolutely power short. But now, let me tell you, the kind of capacities we are adding, very soon this country is going to be, at least if not power sufficient, but more or less power sufficient, if not surplus. But now the issue has come that the finances have to be handled and handled very carefully. And in that, as per the Shunglu committee, which I was a member in, we'll have to do two things. One, the utilities themselves have to tighten up their belts. They need to be more disciplined in their expenditures. At the same time, we also need to have regulators who can see the true costs, ensure that they are passed on, and see that they are passed on in time. There is no sense in giving you or allowing you a cost recovery after the time has passed away. So both ends, I think, need to now look at this issue. But I am sure that in this country, we have sorted out many issues. And this issue also, very soon, we should be able to put it in.
Now, coming to Maharashtra, how is the power scenario in the state with respect to demand and supply? And how would you rate the performance with respect to other progressive DISCOMs in the country?
Today, in Maharashtra, there is no load shedding on industry. Complete industry is load shedding free. 24/7 power we are giving to industries in Maharashtra. Agriculture, we are giving power, assured power supply of 8 hours. If your turn is in the morning, if your turn comes in the evening, you get 10 hours assured supply. All our divisional commissioner towns, that is the 5 major towns, there is no load shedding. 70% of Maharashtra today is load shedding free. There is only 30% which is facing various degrees of load shedding. But that load shedding is because there is a deficit in recovery. There is no way that I can pay for power if the consumer does not pay for power. Finally, as the distribution utility of the state, we buy power and sell it to the consumers. Now, if the consumer does not pay, how do we buy power? After we buy power on your behalf. If you don't pay us, how can we pay? How can we pay the people we buy from? And therefore, there is load shedding in these areas where people do not pay. Now, we are tackling those areas and we have found a very, very positive response. Let me tell you, people in Maharashtra, once they realize that this thing needs to be done, they really come forward and do it. And I must really honestly admit that people are now coming forward. They are realizing that power has to be paid for and they are paying for power. The minute they start paying for power, we will be able to buy more power and give it to them also. So today, if you ask me, there is no large scale load shedding. The deficit, which was something like 4,000 megawatts about 3 to 4 years back, is now down to only about 1,000 megawatt. In fact, the deficit is now just 4% of our energy requirement, which is minuscule by any standards.
Thank you so much, Mr. Mehta, for joining us on Power News. It's time for another short break here. Keep watching Power News.
When you are determined to be a winner, your desire to conquer is fueled by the power of your instinct. With eyes set on the target, you create your own path. Your determination inspires you to never give in. Then emerges a creator of a winning journey, blazing a trail for others to follow. We are Jindal Power Limited.
Almost 40% of India's population does not have access to electricity. Country faces peak power shortage of 12%. Power demand is growing at 9% per year. India power consumption would be doubled by 2020. Can the government meet the growing power demand? Get an exclusive review on the inside stories of critical issues of Indian power sector with me, Juhi Rajput, in Power News, only on Zee Business.
Presented by Raveen Cables Limited.
Welcome back. For the economy to grow at 8 to 9%, it is required that the secondary and tertiary sectors grow at 10 to 11%. India is expected to be home to a skilled workforce of 500 million by 2022. About 12 million persons are expected to join the workforce every year, and this talent pool needs to be adequately skilled. Skill building can be viewed as an instrument to improve the effectiveness and contribution of labor to the overall production. It is an important ingredient to push the production possibility frontier outward and to take growth rate of the economy to a higher trajectory.
Roughly 50% of India's population is under the age of 25. Also, India's working population is expected to account for close to a third of working age population of the world in next two decades. But currently, only 2% of the country's working population is trained in any vocation.
Now, if you look at the total training capacity in the country, you would find that the capacity done by all the ministries and everyone put together is roughly today around at 5 million a year. So if 12.8 million people are joining the workforce every year, close to only one third of them can be skilled.
The construction industry in India has been isolated from the mainstream of vocational training, unlike other sectors. The need for the sector skill council in construction stems from the lack of any structured training for development of trade skills in the construction sector. The SSC intends to put such a structure in place in order to bring about uniformity in training standard based on competency requirement of the construction industry.
All these 20 councils have to train 500 million people, out of which only construction circle strength is 330 million as per this. So all those 18 or 19 or 17 together, and construction sector alone, it has got more than double of the what the all total 18, because it is the biggest circle sector. In that, all infrastructure, building, construction, this real estate, roads, bridges, all these come under construction sector.
The Government of India has undertaken a series of initiatives in the past few years. The budget for 2012-13 has doubled allocation under the National Skill Development Fund and launched a credit guarantee fund for skills development. The budget doubled infusion into the National Skill Development Corporation to Rs. 1000 crore, raising the corpus of the fund to Rs. 2500 crore.
So if you look in the overall framework of the 500 million skill target that has been set by the Prime Minister and very closely monitored by the Prime Minister's National Council on Skill Development. Within that framework, NSDC has got multiple roles to play. The first role is that we need to create coherence and coordination and cohesiveness within private sector in the whole skill development space. The second role that we play is that we actually fund entities wanting to set up skill development programs, and our target in that respect is to actually fund entrepreneurs who would skill about 150 million people between 2008-09 and 2020-22.
In 2011-12, NSDC approved 26 new projects, doubling the number of sanctioned projects since 2009 to 52, with a total funding commitment of Rs. 1,205 crore. At the end of 10 years, these projects are expected to train 62 million people.
This year, the Prime Minister's Council has indicated that the NSDC partners need to skill 400,000 people. We will achieve that target. And what we are very certain about is that as partners begin to scale up, we would see them attaining scale. We will see them attaining, you know, sustainability. And we are actually ensuring that most training organizations do scalable models and repeatable models rather than spread themselves too thin going forward.
Realizing the significance and need for skilled manpower, private sector entities are taking several initiatives to contribute effectively to the government's endeavors. Across business sectors, companies and industry associations are not only boosting their in-house training facilities, but are also taking steps to make potential employees job ready before they join organizations. Industry associations and individual employers are also beginning to show interest involving themselves in the development and management of the ITIs.
Industry organizations, they have to come forward whenever such a situation arises. And that's how Builders Association of India, which is a leading construction body, apex in, body in the Indian construction industry, they have taken several initiatives. Now, even the private entities, as you say, the public-private partnership now has become order of the day. And each activity and each sector, this has come into play. But what is being done is very, very, on a very minuscule level. What is required to be done is mammoth, which everybody has to appreciate.
NSDC has already approved 8 SSCs which will identify current and projected skill gaps in the sectors and develop sector-specific competencies required for different sectors. Government is also promoting public-private partnerships model to foster skill training in the identified sectors. With this, we come to an end of this edition of Power News. Keep sending us your suggestions and views at powernews@znetwork.com or call us on 011-405-60701. Do join us next week for more news and updates. Till then, goodbye and take care.